History is replete with lines that you do not cross. Julius Caesar was not supposed to cross the little stream known as the Rubicon on his way to Rome. The Mason-Dixon line during the American Civil War, you knew what side you were on once you crossed it. The Mendoza line, if you crossed that, that meant you were a terrible baseball player. Well, there's something in the long bond futures market that it's sort of like the Rubicon. I'm exaggerating, of course, but at a certain point, if you cross it, it's bad news. Well, where are we presently on this metric? Well, we're well on our way to Rome. We're approaching Rome's city limits, if you wanted to put it into those terms. So we're going to talk about that next. But before I do, I just wanted to mention, did you know that we have a sponsor? Yes, Eurodollar Enterprises is a 101% real business serving the needs of monetary scientists, academic economists, and central bankers. Available for purchase right now are the Clench 5000, New Dictionary of Economics, and Second Neck Brace. Now, I'm joined by a longtime customer of Eurodollar Enterprises, Jeff Snyder, also the head of Alhambra Investments global research team. Jeff, we're going to be talking about long bond futures and open interest. Long bond futures, that's like multiple long bonds, right? We're referring to what kind of time frames here?
Yeah, it's a bucket of bonds. It's essentially around the 10-year maturity. And used to be long bond futures were all the long bonds until ultra bond futures were introduced many years ago. So It's a specific part of the yield curve, which contains a lot of different specific securities that are deliverable or accepted as delivery for the contract.
Let's define another term, open interest.
Open interest is simply how many contracts have been written are still open. As the term implies, it's the amount of contracts that are registered with the exchange that meet all of the requirements. And usually the CME futures participants are involved in it.
Okay, so the number that we're interested in here is 800,000. And you're going to tell us that's really just kind of a back of the cocktail napkin number that coincidentally has shown that when we cross it, there's trouble in the air. It's not a firm number, right? But let me describe.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you that's really a back of the envelope calculated number. It's not a real number. It's sort of one that we kind of picked out of the air. It's not a hard line. It's one of those that you see time and again, as you were just about to say, and I rudely cut you off, was that, hey, it looks like when we get around this level, we need to start paying closer attention. That's kind of what it is.
Open interest goes up when markets aren't very sure about what's in the future. Since U.S. Treasuries are the settlement product for a variety of shadow trades, especially derivative foreign exchange, what's being hedged here isn't really U.S. Treasury yields or the U.S. government's credit risk. So the more open interest, that means there's more hedging because there's more concern. I suppose that's the punchline. But Jeff, very quick point. I know maybe about a couple of years ago, you took a look at the total number of contracts, because maybe the open interest is just rising because there's more and more and more contracts. Is that what we see in the long bond?
No, we see that in some of the other futures contracts where the markets for them are being more and more developed, whereas the long bond contract sort of normalized to history has sort of stayed the same. Mm-hmm. And the open interest rises and falls with very specific periods in time, which is what we're talking about here. And this 800,000 contract limit is really, we see that market goes past that line, that's when we pay attention, because historically speaking, it says, hey, something is going on here. And what that something is, or at least part of what that something is what we just discussed in the previous segment. There's the basis trade. This is the other part of the basis trade that we just got done talking about for 40 minutes or whatever it was in part one of this episode.
Well, tell us a little bit more about it, because I'm looking at my notes here and it's just scribbled mess and I'm not quite sure where I'm supposed to go next. I don't know who puts these together, these notes.
Yeah, I didn't put my notes. I didn't write it down clearly. No, the base. let's think about what the basis trade was. It was a difference between the futures price and the spot price. So obviously, if there's an arbitrage opportunity, because of this basis trade, then we would expect futures activity to go along with it, because that's half of the trade. Half of the arbitrage is to either long or short the futures, depending on whether it's under or overvalued. And in most cases, what we've seen is that this basis trade we're talking about, or we talked about before, that the hedge funds were hedging or jumping on, was where the futures market or the futures price of a treasury bond was overvalued relative to the spot price. So that corresponds with what we've observed in these long bond futures over open interest, which is, again, the main message, dealers being constrained, which is consistent with dollar shortages, and the basis trade confirming that. Because the dealers aren't able to do it, the hedge fund stepped in, they do it more and more, taking advantage of this opportunity left to them by constrained dealers, which is our telltale sign. Open interest rising, more basis trade, constrained dealers. Constrained dealers correspond to these same periods of generalized illiquidity throughout the world.
And the hedge funds, they were supposed to have stepped in sometime in early 2018. And guess what? When we're looking at the U.S. Treasury bond futures, the long bond here, we see that we're approaching and then cross that 800,000 line of a sign of warning, just as we had seen in the 1998 when we had the LTCM fail, and then 2008 the Bear Stearns, and then 2014 with the third Eurodollar crisis that was focused on East Asia.
And yeah, let's be clear here again. Specifically, the rise in open interest isn't the warning. It isn't. That's just a signal. What it's really telling us, what we're being warned about, is that dealers must be constrained, and that's triggering this symptom of the dealer constraint, which is then what we perceive of as the warning. But that's not the thing that's wrong. The thing that's wrong is not the hedge funds jumping in on the basis trade or shorting treasury bond futures. Those are just the processes of those are the effects of what comes after the initial cause, which always goes back to dealer constraint. So when we see the rising open interest and we put it in the context of the basis trade, what that is telling us is not that we should be concerned about hedge funds shorting treasury bond futures and being long in repo. That's telling us that they're doing that because dealers are constrained, allowing them the profit opportunity to take advantage. That's what we're kind of going backwards, working backwards to a single point of causation, which is the dealer capacities to engage in normal behavior.
Now, Jeff, where does the current open interest stand? And would it be fair to say that seeing a reduction in this open interest would signal relief of the, you know, in the system, the health of the dealers would be returning?
Not necessarily. It would be a signal that something has changed, and then we'd need to figure out what that is. But so long as open interest remains as high, and assuming that it's not some kind of new normal in the futures market, which we always have to, you know, we have to pay attention to that possibility. But assuming this is a continuation of what we've seen since really 2015, 2016, there was a blip in the basis trade back then too, during Eurodollar number three, as you pointed out, that happened as well. But as if we're still in that same dealer shape going back to early 2018, what we call Eurodollar number four, the where open interest in the long bond futures is today is consistent with the idea that hedge funds are still banging away at the basis trade because dealers are not. And if dealers are not doing it, letting the hedge funds take care of it for them, we have to then ask why. Because as everybody's probably heard over the last 14 months or so, the world is flooded with liquidity. Everything's awesome. There's no problems anywhere. Jay Powell has fixed everything. And if he didn't, Christine Lagarde probably did. And there can't possibly be any type of potentially negative monetary impacts. And, you know, open interest kind of tells us, well, maybe dealers are still hugely constrained, and maybe hedge funds are still taking advantage of the basis trades.
So during the 90s, 2008 and 2015, we breached the $800,000 line and then headed just north of a million or approached a million, whereas now it's normal to be above 1 million. Normal, that's just the going rate. So you can see the severity, at least in that shadowy reflection. Another aspect of this article, did I even introduce it? No, I didn't. Jeff, You've got to wave your arms energetically. When I forget to tell people where to go, they can go to Alhambra Investments blog. It was posted on April 23rd, and the blog post title is "The Warehouse Gap Does Much to Fill In Why There Were Never Too Many Treasuries." And I suppose that's your key takeaway from this article, is to once again hammer home the argument, too many treasuries, that the government is too profligate, that it's going to have its comeuppance, and the market's going to boycott this government that's spending wantonly because we don't consider the collateral part. That's your argument here, right? In the media, we hear too many treasuries, but in the details, it's something else.
Yeah, and it almost sounds like the what we're talking about here is too many treasuries, right? Because as we said in the first segment or the first part of the show, dealers said we don't want any more or we can't take any more. How is that not too many treasuries? You have to. What are we? When people were saying too many treasuries, what they were saying is that dealers were like the foreigners in the marketplace, rejecting U.S. treasuries. They didn't want to hold that kind of paper. They were getting stuck with holding more than they ever wanted to because they thought the prices of these things were going to zero. That's the common version of too many treasuries. That's not what happened at all. And you could, I mean, we talked about this many times. I've written about it, you know, many times over the year. That was never the case, and you could tell simply by the market price. Dealers were saying, I mean, again, the warehousing job, the warehousing task of dealers is that, look, I'm going to sell off what I don't want to keep for myself to the financial public. And the secondary market price showed that there was overwhelming demand in the financial public for treasuries, whatever dealers didn't want. And as we talked about in this other paper, the paper that was written earlier this month, that showed that the detailed the basis trade, what they said was, yes, dealers didn't say we don't want this treasuries. They actually wanted a lot of treasuries, but they couldn't take any more because they were dealer. Their balance sheets were constrained for the reason we talked about then. And so, again, just like the secondary market had told you all along, the dealers took a lot of treasuries on their books as much as they possibly could. They would have taken more if they had the ability to, but instead they easily sold them off to the hedge funds who were more than willing to take them off their hands, proving the secondary market price. It was never too many treasuries in the respect that they didn't want these things. It was too many treasuries only in the narrow respect of they were dealer, their balance sheet constrained, and they would have taken more if they could have. But the overall marketplace, there was never too many treasuries, as the market price had said all along. There was always a home for these things because they have value. They have value over and above what most people can assign to it. Because most people correctly see the federal government going absolutely crazy and think, well, there's no way that this debt is worth anything because it's just absolutely nuts. But when you think about treasuries in the context of balance sheet tools or financial tools, they do have significant value.
Then there's not enough of them. My favorite refutation of that big general too many treasuries argument is the primary dealer net positioning for treasuries. You remember that? I don't know. I think it's the Fed, New York Fed, that has that data point. And you can see that from the early 2000s, they were net short. Get rid of this stuff. It's risk-free. Why would I hold it in a return world? But then just a week after August 7th to August 9th, 2007, you can see the inflection, how they started to get less net short and then get net long, and then the undulations and the movement of this primary dealer position just matches perfectly the dollar shortage.
It also matches 2018, remember? There was another spike up in 2018, which we were told, I mean, that was the common conventional explanation was that, oh, dealers are getting stuck with treasuries, that they're have to buy because the government can't find buyers, which was just total bunk. The dealers were taking treasuries, and they would have taken a lot more if they could have, which again is, we keep going back to the same point, is they would have if they could have. And then which means the most important part of this entire episode is why didn't they take more? Why couldn't they have taken more? Why were they balance sheet constrained? The fact that they were balance sheet constrained. And that's really the whole point, is that money in the modern system is really comes down to it. What it all boils down to is balance sheet capacity.
I highlighted these last two paragraphs here because I thought they were excellent, and I wanted to read them all out to the audience. I was going to read one, But I guess you've just said that. And audience, you know, go ahead and come read this article. It's really good. The last two paragraphs are really drive the point home. Jeff, I think we've got it all, but is there anything that we didn't cover in that article that you wanted to bring up now before we move on?
No, I think people are already tired of me saying balance sheet capacity. That's the over. I mean, and that's why we keep emphasizing, is because that's really the point here. When you dig down deep inside the Eurodollar system, that's what drives the whole thing. It's not bank reserves. It's not physical currency. It's balance sheet capacities. And all of the utterly complex, at times beautifully brilliant ways that balance sheets are put together, both on the asset side as well as the liability side.
2 months ago, a U.S. Treasury auction went pear-shaped. You heard about it. It was in the financial media. Well, did you know that a few days ago, another U.S. Treasury auction went, well, I don't want to say it, but the British say, well, I can't say it because I'm going to blush, but they have another phrase for pear-shaped. And we're going to talk about that in part 3. But first, this. From Eurodollar Enterprises. Friends, do you direct the Treasury Ministry? Do your political masters expect foaming asset prices? Are you unsure how to produce lasting froth? Then a box of bath salts from Eurodollar Enterprises is for you! Yes, practice blowing bubbles in the gurgling luxury of your freestanding clawfoot tub. Find the perfect mix between liquidity and hot air with our capital markets foam formulation. Our bubble brew line comes in currencies, commodities, cryptos, and collectibles. Blow them all! Orders received today will come with a fussy central banker, typically retailing for the price of hedge fund general partner, absolutely free. Simulate the political arena trying to blow it in the presence of an erratic technocrat. Don't blow it! Not without bath suds. New! From Eurodollar Enterprises. Central banker swimsuit not included.